Well, good afternoon and everyone, welcome. I'm Tom Landy. I'm the director of the McFarland Center for Religion, Ethics, and Culture at the College of the Holy Cross. The McFarland Center sponsors and supports lectures, conferences, discussions that explore basic questions of meaning, morality, and mutual obligation. This year, having been displaced from our elegant home at Ream Library, we've brought our events on the virtual road, so to speak, via Zoom. So we welcome the alums and others who will bring into our conversations, those who watch us today and those who will watch this afterwards. In the aftermath of the 2016 election and the January 2020 insurrection at the United States Capitol, we're hosting a series of virtual discussions this semester that examine the causes and consequences of the multi-layered political crisis that culminated there, with a particular attention to what it will take to rebuild a deeply fractured nation. Information on the whole series, which we called Repairing the Fabric of Our Nation, is available at bit.ly/repairingthefabric or on the McFarland Center website, where you can watch videos of the past events in the series, and you can also find today's events posted in a couple of days. This Thursday night at 7 o'clock, I'd invite you to the next event in this series, which will be a conversation with Holy Cross's three alumni currently serving in Congress, Senator Bob Casey, Representative Peter Welch, and Representative Mark DeSaulnier, again, about repairing the fabric of our nation. Today, I'm really pleased to be welcoming an extraordinary cohort of veteran Foreign Service officers and policy experts to discuss America's place in the world in light of the divisions that we've witnessed at home. I'll interview them as a group in the first part of the program, and later we'll answer audience questions and some that were submitted beforehand. You can submit your questions anytime using the Q&A function, and I'll field those later. First, let me introduce our discussants. Harry K. Thomas is former ambassador to Zimbabwe, the Philippines, and Bangladesh. He retired in 2018 after 30 years in the United States Foreign Service, having also served during that time as Executive Secretary and Special Assistant to Secretary of State Condoleezza Rice during the George W. Bush administration, as Director of the Foreign Service, as Director for South Asia at the National Security Council, and Director of the Operations Center. Currently, he's Senior Strategic Engagement Leader at the U.S. Special Operations Command and a Senior Fellow at Yale University's Jackson Institute for Global Affairs. Ambassador Thomas is a 1978 graduate of the College of the Holy Cross, a current trustee of the college, and was an honorary degree recipient and commencement speaker in 2016. I'm grateful to him for the generosity he showed in helping to shape the event today, helping me to think about it and call on some of his friends who are here. Robert Tomlinson is Associate Professor in National Security Affairs at the Naval Postgraduate School in Monterey, California. A scholar of the modern Middle East, his area of studies, Shi'a representation in Lebanon. Previously, he directed the Advanced Strategic Leadership Program at the School of Advanced Military Studies. He served 26 years in the Air Force, retiring as a colonel. He is a certified joint specialty officer with service on the joint staff and has commanded the squadron level in the Air Force and the group level too. I missed that. Dr. Tomlinson is a member of the Holy Cross class of 1974. And a graduate of the college's ROTC program. He earned a PhD in modern Middle Eastern history and national security policy from Claremont Graduate University. Susan Elliott, another ambassador, is president and CEO of the National Committee on American Foreign Policy. In her 27-year diplomatic career, she was civilian deputy and foreign policy advisor to the commander of the United States European Command, ambassador to Tajikistan, and Deputy Assistant Secretary of State for South and Central Asian Affairs. Previous overseas assignments included posts in Moscow, where she was Minister Counselor for Political Affairs, in Belfast, as the Consul General, and in Athens. She served as Deputy Executive Secretary and Director of the Executive Secretariat Staff of former Secretary of State Condoleezza Rice. She's taught at Ball State University and the University of Virginia in Charlottesville. She holds a doctoral degree from the Indiana University. Dave Rank is a senior fellow at Yale University's Jackson Institute for Global Affairs and is head of the China practice at the Cohen Group, a global business strategy consultancy, and he teaches at Johns Hopkins University School for Advanced International Studies and at the University of Wisconsin's La Follette School of Public Policy. He spent 27 years as a State Department Foreign Service officer. His final assignment as Deputy Chief of Mission and, following the 2016 election, as a Chargé d'Affaires or Acting Ambassador at the U.S. Embassy in Beijing. He resigned it in June of 2017 after the Trump administration announced it would withdraw from the Paris Climate Agreement, explaining in a Washington Post op-ed, quote, as a parent, patriot, and Christian, I could not in good conscience be involved in any way, no matter how small, with the implementation of that decision. In addition to foreign service assignments in Greater China, he served in Washington and at the U.S. embassies in Kabul, Athens, and Port Louis, Mauritius. In 2015, he received the State Department's Distinguished Honor Award for his role in the release of the only American service member held by the enemy in Afghanistan. I'm going to add a disclaimer for all of them that none of our discussants will be speaking on behalf of the organizations that they work for, solely on their own behalf. We have a remarkable group here, as you can tell, and I only touched upon some of the things about them. Expertise grounded in work around the globe, and frankly, I'm dazzled simply by the language expertise that's gathered in this Zoom room. We have other kinds of expertise, of area expertise that we'll want to address today. Matters of security, pandemics, the environment, hunger, development, global trade, human rights, and all 1 hour to talk about it. So let me start with this, so whoever would want to start. The premise of today's conversation is that America's domestic politics of division in recent years matters on a global stage, and that those politics of division have undermined America's ability to lead, diminishing our role in shaping the world. Does that hold true in your own, from your vantage points?
I mean, I'm willing to start, Tom, if that's okay with you.
Thank you.
I just would tell the audience a little bit about, you know, what I do at the National Committee on American Foreign Policy. And we, the majority of our work, other than public programs like this one, we do track two discussions. So we bring together people, experts, scholars, former government officials to discuss whether it's conflict resolution or other kinds of issues. So over the past 3 years in my job since I retired, we have, I think, played a vital role in bringing people together, not government to government, because there wasn't a lot of government to government discussion going on, especially in countries like Russia, like China. And we were able to hear what people on the ground were saying. We used to bring people together in person, but we've successfully over the past year done these discussions virtually. In fact, a year ago, because we talked with people from mainland China and Taiwan, you know, we thought, will they ever talk to us in a webinar, or, you know, in a format virtually, and they have, and it's been very successful. But what have, I think the thing that has concerned me that I've heard from scholars, and I don't only do Asia, I talk with people in the Western Balkans, I do Northern Ireland, we do Russia, we do the Middle East, so I kind of hit the, you know, the whole world, Africa. But the question I think that concerned a lot of our friends around the world is America a reliable partner? And why do I say that? You mentioned, you know, Dave's brave decision to leave the Foreign Service because of the Paris Climate Accord, but we withdrew from the Paris Climate Accord. We withdrew from the Joint Comprehensive Plan of Action, you know, on Iran. We withdrew from the Trans-Pacific Trade Agreement, you know, partnership trade. We also withdrew from the WHO. So I think what I feel that the service that my organization, the people like Harry and like Dave, who have participated in some of our discussions from the American side, is to reassure people that, you know, that people in America do care about our multilateral interests. We are a reliable partner. And I think there's a lot of hope from friends around the world when they hear President Biden saying he wants to reengage multilaterally. He wants to build America back better. He doesn't mean that he's a pushover with countries like Russia, or China, or Iran, but that, you know, we, I think, as former diplomats, understand the importance of engaging with not only allies, but, you know, all people around the world. So I'll leave it at that. But I would say that, you know, we need to reestablish our reliability. I'll just give you one anecdote. When I served in Central Asia, I not only covered all the countries of former Central Asia, as well as being ambassador to Tajikistan, but I had several Central Asians say to me that America, and this was probably 5-6 years ago, that America was a reliable partner, unlike other countries that have influence in the region, like Russia, like China, like Iran, that, that you know, if we said we were going to do something, then we did it. And so I think that's the thing that our friends around the world are looking for. In fact, my one friend said, this was in probably about 2015 when he said this, he said, Boris Yeltsin promised me some assistance in 1998, and I'm still waiting for it. So that's what I'd like to see, is that, you know, we restore confidence, not only, I won't talk about domestically, we can get into that, but, you know, more that that are that people around the world have confidence that America is a reliable partner.
So I appreciate that, that theme of reliable partnership. Maybe a way to build on the question, if someone else wants to pick up on it, if you imagined your own career for our students who are 20, 22, if you imagine your own self in the position, maybe 4 or 14 or at some early point in your career in government service, what is different about that now from the perspective that we're talking about?
I'll tell you what's different. This, right? I laugh with, of course, we're all of a certain age on this side of the Zoom screen that, you know, 1990 when I started and when Susan started, because we came into the Foreign Service together, we walked around with it was about the size of, well, I was going to say the size of a phone book, but probably most of the people on this conversation haven't seen a phone book either, but the size of a couple of bricks taped together. And that was the way you could communicate with the rest of the world. I happened to be in Shanghai at the time, and the world moved at a statelier pace. It just moved much more slowly than it does today. And you had a little time to reflect. Both if something happened in the country where you happen to be, or to reflect on, you know, what is our role in the world. And now things move so quickly that if you are not, you know, if the, your phone rings, it's ringing in Beijing and in Washington and in Moscow all at the same time. And just keeping up with that pace of change, the shock of the immediate, that something that happens here is happening around the world, is a real challenge. And it's something that I think you all on the other side of the screen will be dealing with during your careers, just the acceleration of the pace of change.
Thanks. Ambassador Thomas or Harry?
Yeah, let me add something to what Susan and Dave said. I work in the national security and the national defense space, and the idea of our domestic politics affecting our alliance structure is something that we speak about a lot. Now, as my Foreign Service friends here in this panel understand that, alliance structures are very, very tough to build and sometimes are easily shattered. And if you're going to operate in the national defense space, you have to have alliances. They support us in what we intend to do. They help us logistically, but it takes time and effort to make sure that our partners think that we're reliable. And when that's shaken domestically and people have messaging that maybe we're not a reliable partner, that affects us tremendously. And I think that's something for us to think about and maybe talk about a little bit later, how the last 4 years particularly has affected us as a reliable partner in the future.
Appreciate that. Harry, any thoughts to add to that? It's something that's changed in terms of...
Yes, thank you. I agree with all of our colleagues. I just think the most important thing in addition to reliability is leadership. Mm-hmm. And for the things the students care about and that we care about, solving the pandemic, fighting human trafficking, ending HIV/AIDS, protecting the climate, protecting labor, international labor, supply chain, all of these things that benefit the United States as well as the international community, we and have benefited us from the time we were junior officers, is because of American leadership. not only leadership, but sacrifice and willingness to share in the spoils and the leadership. And this has benefited us. And you've seen in the last years, when we have not been willing to take those leadership roles, other nations have not stepped up. Has Germany done it? Has Japan done it? Has Korea? They don't see those as their roles. And for many, many reasons, which we understand. At the same time, Dave can explain better, and Susan, why China and Russia have not and will not, but they have not. Those are not issues of interest to them. And we can, so many of these things, I want Americans, and particularly the students, to understand have benefited us. Reliability benefits the United States and allows us to not only shape, but listen to others who have shared interests as we go forward.
Harry, if I can I pick up on that, Tom? Because there are a couple of other attributes that I think are really important that sort of America doesn't work, either here at home or abroad, if we don't have a combination of ambition, of humility, and of competence. And ambition in the sense that, you know, we aspire to a more perfect union. You know, that's a pretty a pretty tall order. But the humility to recognize that what that means by implication is that we are imperfect, that, you know, we need to improve. And I guess those two have been missing to some degree in the last 4 years, and the third has been missing as well, the competence that, and you talked about my op-ed. When I left government, one of the things I talked about was my concern about the denigration of expertise and the importance of sort of knowing your game, of knowing the issue that you're involved with, you know, bringing competence to the things we do. And I think that's what the international community has missed, that combination of the three, of American aspiration to leadership, of humility, recognizing that it's not just the United States that we have to be working for, and the competence to bring the leadership that Harry, you talked about.
So I'm intrigued by that, and I'll go back a couple of times. I mentioned to you both earlier that there was a time when I wanted to work for the Foreign Service and didn't do that. So I went to graduate school, and in graduate school, at least at the University of Chicago, where I studied international relations, everything was about realism. So while I am an idealist, I may come back at you with some kind of realist questions. And one of them is, in terms of what matters, if you will, I was trying to look at the questions on there. Is our role really as leaders, as a country that's a leader, to what degree is it dependent on those kinds of intangibles that you're talking about, or the kind of vision that you're talking about, Dave? And how much of it really is about hard power realities, about the strengths that we have compared to China, to other countries, about our military strength? Which are really more important for us, and how do we balance those? Because obviously those things have changed in the time that we've talked about since you started into the present day. So how would you
balance? Yeah, I'll start, but I know my colleagues have thoughts too. I think one of the things that has made the United States, enabled us to be the leaders we have been over the last 70 years, is that we were willing to be bound by the institutions that we created, that we were willing to be bound by the laws that we put out there. And by and large, if there were international norms, international rules, you could count on the United States to live up to those rules. We didn't do it without exception. There are some clear, you know, I think you have to be humble as you look at American history, be humble about our record, that it's not spotless, but people around the world could look at the United States and say, and have confidence in where we would come down on issues. I think they look right now at the potential vacuum of leadership globally if the United States steps out of that role with real trepidation, that there is no one else, and Harry, you talked about this, ready to step forward and bind itself to those international norms that have enabled the explosion of prosperity over the last 70 years.
So Susan, maybe when you look at Russia, how would the Russians sort of look at that? Is our power based on the kind of leadership intangible things, or is the power based on the hard realities of our Army, Navy, our economy?
Well, I mean, clearly, you know, we have, and if you go back to Soviet times, that what how we engage with Soviet Union was looking at, you know, both of us as a military and a nuclear power. However, I will say that we both sides made sure that we had treaties, we had, you know, we had norms that we followed. Now, that said, I think that, you know, the not following the rules, as Dave mentioned, and that, you know, we had a rules-based order, and if people don't follow the rules, then it makes it difficult, you know, to engage. And I think this is, you know, what we've seen maybe over the past few years in the U.S. is that, you know, people in America are saying, well, wait a minute, we follow the rules. And then, you know, other people, and maybe this is in relation to China, I'm not saying that I agree with this, but they don't follow the rules. That's why China has moved up so quickly, because we've helped them, we've followed the rules, you know, they haven't. But I think the other thing, even going back to what Harry said about leadership, you know, it can be leadership in a variety of areas. And if we just look at, you know, some of the things that Harry mentioned in terms of, you know, things that are important to me, being a leader in terms of the pandemic, I think one of the things that really has made me unhappy over the past year is that we didn't step forward. Yes, we have to take care of our own, but we also should be a leader in the efforts to have equity in terms of vaccines, in terms of, you know, pandemic care. And I think that's one of the things I was very pleased to see that President Biden has pledged money to the, you know, the vaccine effort. But if you look at some of the statistics, you know, it will be till 2023 before countries, some of the countries in sub-Saharan Africa and other poorer countries have been, you know, have, you know, will be able to be vaccinated. So that creates inequity. And I think one of the things that I will say, maybe countries like China and Russia haven't stepped up to fill the a void that maybe we haven't done, but they have done what I'll call soft power. I mean, if you look at vaccine distribution, for example, I engage a lot with people of the Western Balkans, and Serbia is getting vaccines at a pretty good rate. They've been vaccinated pretty well, better than the rest of the European Union, because they've been getting vaccines from Russia. And they look to the West to help them, but they seem to be getting help from the East. Same thing with China. Both Russia and China in Central Asia have been engaged in trying to get vaccines out to the people there. And so I think people look at that and say, well, wait a minute, we always thought that the U.S. would be the leader in this area, because it's not just about our strength and our power, but our willingness to be, you know, development and other ways to, you know, to help others around the world. So I think it's a kind of a combination of, you know, having the right balance of, you know, showing that we're strong, but also that we follow the rules. And to me, that's what a great leader, that's why we've been a successful country. And, you know, I won't keep going because I've talked too long, but then, and then looking at what are we showing to people around the world about what's going on in our own country. You know, again, I served in Belfast, Northern Ireland. I had friends from Northern Ireland who emailed me on January 6th and like said, OMG, this looks like, you know, Northern Ireland during the Troubles. And, you know, we're very concerned that the bright star that people, why do you think people come over our border? Because they seek a better life in the U.S. And if we don't have this here, we need to take a look at ourselves, because we do project to the world that we are a democracy and we're a strong democracy. And so we've got to make sure that we lead by example.
Great. Let me ask one question. I want to come back and think about, we've talked about January 6th, but it's been a year of terrible domestic things too. And one of the things that's been revealed, I would say, is the depth of American racism that many people might have dismissed before. And can any of you speak how concretely, whether it's the events at Charlottesville, the murders of George Floyd and Breonna Taylor and Ahmaud Arbery and so many others, how did they, can you say concretely how they impacted America's ability to lead? Were states naive about our problems before, or do you see any examples of ways that it's severely undermined our moral standing abroad? We're not the only country that faces those challenges, but we haven't faced them well recently.
Yeah, well, let me try to take this one on. Words matter. And when we portray to the rest of the world that we are a multicultural, multiracial democracy, but we don't live those examples, I think it has a profound effect on how we're perceived in the rest of the world. And for those of us who are minorities, this is nothing new. We knew that there was a great deal of undercurrent of this racial division. But when you put it out to the rest of the world and you don't live by the examples that you talk about, I think it has profound effects. And here's the other thing for the national security realm, is that our adversaries, our competitors, will use those things to exploit these divisions internally. And they don't care who wins this contest or fight. All they want is a fight. And so we, as national security professionals, as diplomats, have to be aware of that, that these internal problems have issues outside of just what happens in the United States.
Certainly Putin has tried that strategy, but he's not alone in that. So any other thoughts on that? I think that's a good summary. Any examples?
Yeah, Tom, one of the things that we saw, particularly after George Floyd was killed, is protest marches around the world, initially in sympathy, in Osaka, in Dominican Republic, in the Netherlands, Japan. Our ambassador in South Korea put out a BLM flag draped over the embassy, retired admiral, before he was told to take it down by then Secretary Pompeo. Those protests quickly changed to people trying to protest for their rights in their countries. Many of them were minorities, gays, and then minorities in other countries can be tribal, ethnic also. So you saw that, and it was something that is particularly important because a lot of those countries, the minorities, the women, immigrants are suffering. They're totally marginalized. And this is what's come up. Now, the United States can't preach to them now, but we can try to work with them, understanding them. We can't go to Mexico and talk about race because everybody's a Mexican. It's like France, you know? You have to talk about what you can do, particularly in Mexico. And that's what I want the students to understand. What works in Mexico? What influences work in Mexico? What works in Worcester is not going to work in Mexico when you're trying to help people. But we can do these things, and we should. And that's, I come back to what David said. I try to refer everybody to The Soul of America by John Meacham. Remember, David was talking about a more perfect union. We say we are imperfect, and we're trying to be perfect, and we have to be honest about our errors, our mistakes. On Sunday, I was talking to a friend of mine Saturday about what's going on in the Philippines and the challenges they had there. And afterwards, I saw the World War II in the Pacific and it said how the US saved the Philippines from the Spanish. Well, we didn't quite save the Philippines from the Spanish. So those type things, especially in the age of social media, you have to be honest, be open, and committed to change. I still say, with all of the problems we face, only the United States could Barack Obama have been elected president. Not in Kenya, given his family status as a minority ethnic group, his father a Muslim, that would not have happened. So while we look at our flaws and we try to change them, we also have to celebrate our strengths.
I just wanted to follow up on something that Harry said, or everyone said, as having served in Belfast, Northern Ireland, for any of the viewers who've never been there, they have a lot of murals, and there's a mural of Rosa Parks. And why? Because a lot of the turmoil that led to the Good Friday Agreement was people, definitely not people of color, but people who were different, you know, different religion, different point of view, political point of view on whether Ireland should be part of the UK or the island of Ireland should be united. But they saw what we were doing in the US and they used that as an example. So I think, you know, going back to, you know, words, what Bob said, words do matter, actions matter. And I think people have seen us as a country that is willing, you know, you couldn't have these kind of conversations in many of the countries that I, you know, that I served in. In fact, when I was the ambassador in Tajikistan, I had young women all the time who were really, well, how did you get to be an ambassador? And, you know, because a woman really could not have done the kinds of things that a woman in the US could do. And so I think people do look to us for, you know, our way of life, and it's important. Thanks.
Yeah, I think the Rosa Parks is a great example. I mean, in the 1960s, what happened to Rosa Parks was shameful, right? It was humiliating. As an American, you at the time, a humble American, you had to be, it's an awful experience. But if you look back, I mean, that strengthened us. The reaction, the action that Americans took in response to that strengthened us as a country. Now that doesn't, you know, as they say on the investment ads, past performance does not guarantee future results. So you can turn bad to good, but you got to work at it. And I think that's the challenge that we face. And I think, Susan, you talked about this, the fact that the Biden administration recognizes that fixing foreign policy means first and foremost, fixing what's going on in the US is very clearly, I think he's on to something.
Dave, in terms of China, China's tried to play it. And I've heard this from young Chinese, hearing from parents, all of this from Black Lives Matter to January 6th. This is what happens in America. We have a better system than you. This is what democracy wields, is all of this chaos. Count on us, the party, to keep things right. Is that going to work for places? Is it working for the Chinese, do you think?
Let me try to get at this, because we haven't talked about this great power competition, which is in all our national security documents right now. And again, it's a competition. How that competition manifests itself is in various forms. One of it is in what people believe is the system that they would most like to deal with and live with. And as Susan talked about, and Dave talked about, competency matters. So you have to demonstrate that as compared to a system like China or Russia. You have to demonstrate that your society works. Okay, democracy is messy, but also it brings about a lot of great innovation and other great things. And that has to be championed. And you can't just rely upon the hard power, the M all the time, military power, or even economic power to get your ways. It's a competition across the span of what we call dime diplomacy, information, military, and economic capabilities of countries. And we've got to compete against China and Russia's and the others to make sure people understand, or make sure that people are bought to this idea of democracy.
Great. I would add to that, you know, on the part of competition and people talking about China and what have you, is that, again, we need to invest in ourselves. And investing ourselves doesn't mean that we're putting a wall around our country and not interacting with our, you know, with other countries around the world. But, you know, to me, if we're in a competition with China or Russia or any country, the best way for us to be a strong ally and partner is to make sure that we build strong, whether it's protecting our cyber security, it's protecting our, you know, supply chains, building back better, you know, our economy. All those things make us better able to deal with either adversaries and allies around the world.
I agree. Harry, maybe I'll ask you a question since you had time in the Philippines, and this may put you a little bit on the spot given the person I'm going to mention. But in terms of, we were talking about what we're an example of. We had some great positive examples of what we are, but this is an era when we've got, to make some value judgment, Duterte, Bolsonaro, we could add to that, Erdogan. It hasn't been the, you know, things look different than they did in the 90s about, you know, democracy and everything coming. Are we an example that's caused this? Are there other forces about globalization that are doing this? How do you ascribe, say, the rise of figures who are less than, who are autocratic?
Well, they've always been there and they always will be there, unfortunately, as well as populists. These are Duterte in the Philippines won in a democratic election.
Correct.
The people of the Philippines say the wealthy, many of whom educated in the United States and a bunch at Holy Cross, did nothing for them. They carved a policy where they want 15% of their nation to immigrate so they can send remittances back. That they didn't end terrorism, which has been going on and off in the southern part of the Philippines for over 100 years. That if you're a college graduate, you're lucky to work at Starbucks or in a hotel on a contract that's short term with no real rights. So when the wealthy do nothing for you, you look to the populace, whether that's in the United States or the Philippines or Turkey. And so you have to respond to everyone. And in the United States, we have to do that. Look at it this way. We are all fortunate to be in the positions we are. Myself, I was shocked last year when I knew that 80% of the population was getting a stimulus check. And I realized how out of touch I was with that. And I would argue that most of my friends on this panel and at the Cross were not getting stimulus checks. Most of the people, as much as we implore the importance of the Trans-Pacific Partnership and NAFTA, they look on that as something they lost at. Why? Do we need to correct that? Do we need to better explain that? It's hard to argue with emotionalism, but there is a growing inequality among all classes in our nation. And if we do not find ways to solve that, Mr. Trump will not be the last populist.
Well, that multilateralism is probably the heart of one of the structural questions. Many people would say the kind of neoliberal state and the displacement that it's brought. Will we see more of that? Should we see more of that in the future? Is that a way to fix our domestic condition in the world? Or is it something we should kind of put the brakes on temporarily? Where do we come down on that? Or what should we look for in the future?
I will defer to my colleagues and then come back.
I mean, I would just say that we have to, again, look at, and I don't think we've done a good job of this, is, you know, showing to Americans why it's important to engage and why it's important to trade with other countries, why the TPP is important, why the Paris Climate Accord is important, and that if we don't do that, again, I say we want to keep ourselves strong, but we can't do it without making the case to the people of America that this will make you better. And that perhaps from what Harry said, you know, there's growing inequity in the US. But is that the fault of us, diplomacy and, you know, trade with China, or are there other factors? And I would maintain that we need to do a better job of, you know, making people understand that this engagement outside our borders is good for the people of our country. I don't think we've done a good job of it.
Okay. Maybe another question, the Middle East. So we talked about a lot of tough spots, and that may fall to you a little bit more, Bob, but anyone's welcome to take it up. To what degree did... have we made progress there? We seem in some ways, Syria has been a mess. We're in a different state, but how do we think about what's happened in the Middle East in the last years? There's a reconfiguration. Israel's state is different, but Yemen is a war. So Lebanon's maybe in a perilous place, but.
Well, Tom, if you want a short career, try to make predictions about the Middle East. And so I've been there a lot. I've studied it, obviously, a lot. I think we need to recognize that this is not the Middle East 20 or 30 years ago. And there are other forces that are at place. Now, this is again my way of thinking here, but I hearken back to John Mersheimer's idea of an offshore balancer. Right now, I think you see the emergence of three major powers in the Middle East, and that's Iran, Turkey, and Israel, okay? And they are gonna have to sort that out, okay? Without anyone, I believe, taking an overall or dynamic position that destabilizes that. Now, that's not gonna be pretty. It's probably gonna be a little bit ugly, but if we think that we're gonna involve ourselves and stay there and shape it like I think people did back in 2000, I think that's a recipe for disaster. And again, you know, Harry's got some expertise. I know Dave and probably Susan, but that's my thoughts on the Middle East. We need to look at the competition between those three nations and make sure that no one gets, I think, a huge advantage, and let them sort it out.
Bob, I'm going to disagree with you. You are completely wrong. I have zero expertise on the Middle East. But I will say, I know a little about the U.S., and I think it's really, I hope President Biden's paying attention, that there were three straight presidential elections, two Obama terms and Trump's term, where the winning candidate ran on a platform of we need to end what we're doing, end these forever wars in Iraq and Afghanistan. And it's not sustainable, a policy that a foreign policy is not sustainable if you don't have the support of the people fundamentally. And so I think at some point, our policy's got to get back into line with where American opinion is. Either American opinion's got to shift to saying, yes, this is a good use of American resources, you know, blood and treasure, or that we reduce our military footprint, military involvement in that part of the world.
Yeah, Afghanistan is where I know a little bit about. President Biden has a deadline of May 1st. He hasn't moved from that deadline. He's kept Zalmay Khalilzad, President Trump's negotiator. Bob, you're in the military. Logistically, getting 2,500 troops plus sensitive equipment out of a landlocked country by May 1 is very difficult. Yeah. So what does President Biden do? The Taliban is not attacking us because they would rather win through negotiations than battle. But if they see him stay, they're going to attack. And the generals of whom I respect are always going to say, we can win, we can stabilize. Well, we sent our best, Petraeus, McChrystal, all of these. Result is the same. For the students, in 2000, when I was being interviewed by Dr. Rice and Stephen Hadley to work at the National Security Council, they asked me, it was a spring, what should we do about Afghanistan? I said, nothing. We need not to go in there because everybody who goes in there gets burned. And if you know Dr. Rice, she's very calm. She almost jumped out of her chair and said, you're right. 6 months later, we all got swept up. Not that I was a policymaker, let me be clear, but we were all swept up. We were going to change Afghanistan. We were going to make it better. I had a policy for the ring road around the country. We were going to, you know, bring the Bloods and the Crips together in the sense of making it work. And we didn't because we ignored history. We didn't look at it. Now our pride is involved, but at a cost of thousands of American and Afghan lives and international commitment. So really it is time. Didn't make any difference staying longer in Vietnam and it won't in Afghanistan. Unfortunately.
One of our students is asking, how is America currently working to change other countries' perceptions of the US after Trump? I know you're retired now, so you're on the outside looking in maybe, but you have good connections. What are we doing right now?
Well, one of the things that all countries look at is our national security strategy. It's a key strategic document. And just this month, the Biden administration put out an international security strategic guidance. So I would tell that student to read those 20 pages, and it's really instrumental in outlining what the Biden administration intends to do. And it's much of what we've talked about before, which is re-engaging our allies, putting emphasis on rebuilding our own expertise at home, and looking at this competition with Russia and China from a holistic point of view, using all those instruments of power that I talked about.
I mean, I think with COVID raging, no one can get past that. And so I think the Biden administration, I talked about competence in my opening comments, and I think that's really they understand that that's the test, not just for how the rest of the world looks at us, but, you know, as the richest country in the world with the highest death rate, the highest infection rate, you can't sort of dress that up. You have to address that, most importantly, because, you know, until you get the pandemic under control, you can't get the economy back online. You can't get society open back up. But you can't really paint an optimistic portrait of the United States engaged and leading in the world if we are not engaged and leading within our own country. And so I think smartly they have ended sort of the hands-off, let the states figure it out policy of the previous administration, and much more actively encourage states to take steps to get the pandemic under control. And I think demonstrating competence will go a long way towards people giving us the benefit of the doubt, giving the administration the benefit of the doubt on the things you talked about, Bob, you know, the more wonkier details of a national security policy.
Another question, when President Obama spent a lot of his energy working on the Iran nuclear agreement, we know what's happened with that. He also supposedly left behind one of his biggest concerns was North Korea. Are those still priorities the way they were? We saw what's happened with both of those. Are there other areas we move on? So the question, I guess, would continue sort of where else are priorities? Are there other ways? Do we kind of leave those aside? Do we expend energy on those right now?
You know, I can, my organization has a long history of engaging on North Korea. And I would say I was very pleased to see I think there was an article last week about how quietly that the Biden administration has reached out to Chairman Kim. They haven't heard back, but I think that was a good sign. I will also say that I think it was good what President Trump did in trying to engage the North Koreans. I would say that perhaps, and having worked at the Foreign Service, you know, one of the problems is not using the expertise, as David mentioned, to help to try to formulate and figure out, you know, how we would best deal with the North Koreans. So I think that has to be a priority. And it's one thing that I think, you know, in looking at how can we have better relationships around the world, doesn't mean we have to be friends with the Chinese or the Russians. But if you look at North Korea and stability in Northeast Asia is something that is of interest to the Chinese. It's interest to our allies in Japan and Republic of Korea. I'm very glad to see that Secretary Biden, Secretary Austin are there now, you know, engaging with our allies, who I think also felt a little bit concerned about what was our commitment, you know, to them in a region where, you know, North Korea and China has nuclear weapons. And so I think it's the same with other countries around the world. I think Iran, you know, clearly Bob pointed out that, you know, in the Middle East, Turkey, Iran, and Israel are all strong players. So I don't think we can ignore, and I think we need, I'm for, and maybe it's because I spent you know, almost 30 years as a diplomat. I'm for engaging. And what's that saying is you keep your friends close, but you keep your enemies closer. I mean, I heard Secretary Austin say today in his meeting, you know, with our allies in South Korea and Japan, that he's the leader of our military and somebody I worked with when he was leader of CENTCOM. But he said, you know, he supports and thinks that diplomacy is the answer. So, you know, in order for us to get out of these forever wars, we need to figure out ways that we can better engage, you know, with the people in the regions. It may be a little bit idealistic, but I think, you know, talking across the table is much better than, you know, having to do a military action against a country.
Well, Susan, if I can pick up on that, I think it's good to put North Korea and Iran together because some of you may remember in the 1990s, there was an imperfect agreement that put a cap on the North Korean nuclear program, was dismantling it. We, the United States, made the perfect the enemy of the good and blew that agreement up. And as a consequence, now we're faced with North Korea that has 30 nuclear weapons and is a far, far more complicated issue to deal with. I fear that that's what we're doing with Iran, that the Obama administration reached a deal that was, by all accounts, including by the accounts of the people who negotiated it, imperfect. But where we are now is no agreement at all, no restraints on the Iranian program, except for those that we can unilaterally put in place. And we face the prospect of the equivalent of North Korea sitting in the middle of the Middle East. A real tough situation.
I would agree. I agree 100% with you, Dave. And the one thing that I would add, again, in looking for ways, I'll call them confidence building measures, but the JCPOA included China and Russia. So it's a way that we could engage with people that we aren't having great relationships with on an area of interest. So it is unfortunate that we aren't involved in it. It was an imperfect agreement, I would say that, you know, today. But, you know, even talking about and looking at Brexit, you know, I talk a lot about Northern Ireland, you know, that the Good Friday Agreement was good when it was done. But, you know, now are there changes that need to be made given the situation, you know, more than 20 years on?
Let me push back on my friend Dave, just a little bit. I think that the big difference between North Korea and Iran is the position of countries around them. Iran is definitely balanced by countries like Turkey and to some extent other countries around them. For North Korea, the status quo almost benefits everybody. I mean, Japan doesn't want to see a unified Korea under the auspices of South Korea. Russia and China certainly want to see that either. So maintaining a quasi-status quo is a little bit different than the situation would be in vis-a-vis Iran. So I said that's a big difference there.
One of the questions on the Paris Climate Accord, Dave, you obviously cared a great deal about it. Can we get that going and started again?
I mean, we're back in. I think the problem with Paris was always that it was never ambitious enough. Not that it required too much of us, but that it didn't require enough of us. And so the question is not going to be, can we get back into Paris? We're in the process of re-entering. I think that takes effect 30 days after we re-sign. We may formally be back in now. But really the question is, what do we do now? That Paris wasn't enough then. It's clearly not enough now. So what are the next steps? Does it require another international agreement? Those are tough. You know, getting 180 countries all to the same place is a really difficult challenge on any issue. Will it require, sort of like global trade has taken, different groups moving at different speeds, pushing in the same direction? But without a country like the United States that has the political heft and the competence, the understanding of the issues, the science, the economics of climate change, that really it makes it far, far more difficult. The EU just is not a mechanism that's capable of doing that sort of thing. China isn't trusted, isn't transparent enough about its own efforts, and frankly is involved in so many continuing to build up the really dirty side of the industry at home and in the Belt and Road countries, that it's not an adequate leader on that. So it kind of has to be the United States.
Thanks. One of our pre-submitted questions, with the international community being in the multipolar state that it is today, do you see an end to the period of relative stability that's been enjoyed since the conclusion of World War II? From a student.
I would say I hope not. But, you know,
systems don't run themselves. I worry. I mean, the U.S. had, you know, we created the system. It benefited us in a lot of ways, and we spent a lot of effort keeping the system running. The system being sort of the alliance system and the WTO and all those other sort of structures that made up the global system. And if I feel like at times we all were part of it, like Lucille Ball at the chocolate factory, with, you know, things coming off and us trying to keep up. But when you stop doing that, it starts breaking down. And I worry about that, what happens then.
Well, and that's one thing that I would say, even, you know, to the students who are listening, is that these institutions that were created post-World War II, with Bretton Woods and the, you know, the International Monetary Fund, the World Bank, the WTO, I believe in multilateralism, but I also believe that we need to be looking at, you know, now almost coming up to 100 years on, you know, how are there structural changes that we need to make to adapt, you know, to the challenges of, you know, of this century?
Great. Yeah, I would agree with Dave and Susan here. And I tell this to my students all the time, before you tear structures down, you need to understand why they were built in the first place. Okay. And so, yes, it's been 70, 80 years since the end of World War II and how we built the structures that Susan talked about, but they were built for a reason, to keep the stability. And so as you try to rip those apart and say, NATO's no longer important, bilateral treaties in the Pacific are no longer important, be careful what happens when those go away, because you leave an opening for the possibility of conflict, which Dave and Susan, and I'm sure Harry, think about all the time.
Let me go to another student question, and maybe I'll start with Harry on that. Though your paths are likely very different, what advice can you give to students who are aspiring diplomats? What courses or opportunities do you recommend that we take advantage of, and what skills can we begin to develop while studying at Holy Cross?
Well, you know, all you have to be is 21 and an American citizen and pass the Foreign Service exam. You don't have to be a college graduate. For me, what I think would have made me a better diplomat, especially initially, was junior year abroad, which we didn't want to leave Worcester in those days, Bob. study of languages. I really encourage you to study languages, not just Spanish and French, but Mandarin and Hindi and Bengali or whatever, Farsi. Take those courses, which are now given. The Jesuits have a great tradition of questioning authority and continue to question authority, question conventionalism. It's extremely important. Last three are the same as when we went to school. Learn to communicate well in terms of your drafting ability and your oral speaking ability. And don't have a ego. Because in the State Department, we would edit Mark Twain. I'm not joking. So we are not. So do not feel bad.
He was my boss. I agree.
when that happens, lastly, be kind. Take time to always be kind, humble, and never compromise your honest principles. Do not lie.
Yeah.
It's harder than I say. It's hard. It's not easy not to lie, but don't.
And, you know, I think communication is extremely important. I don't have any. So just to tell you, I joined the Foreign Service when I was 38 years old. It's a second career for me. I didn't have any background in international relations, but communication, I think, is extremely important, you know, as a diplomat, not only getting the U.S. point of view across, but then listening. And one of the things you have to do is communicate to Washington what you're hearing on the ground. And I think that's extremely important. Try to put yourself in the position of the people who you're dealing with in the country, and learning foreign language. I definitely think that's something we don't do enough of in the US. And that makes you humble, because you really, you know, you have to put yourself, I think, to me, the people who do well at languages, other than if you learn them at a very young age, but, you know, you have to be willing to make mistakes and, you know, allow people to correct you. And you really learn a lot about another culture and another other people by learning foreign language.
So Tom, until 2016, I used to tell people the best preparation that I had was being a Chicago Cubs fan. Because it teaches you pain, teaches you to suffer, and to hope for next year. Of course, 2016, they blew it and won the World Series, but also to be optimistic in the face of empirical evidence. But I would say, if you're asking people for an objective view of whether to join the State Department, you're talking to the wrong bunch here with Harry, Susan, Lee, because we are all, I think, unabashed supporters. We will only give you the positive of what is really a terrific, it was for me anyway, way to spend 27 years of my professional career.
I 100% agree on that. And I encourage all of you, State Department and government service needs good people. And it was a second career for me. You know, I was 38 and Dave was 18 when we joined. But, you know, that was really hard for me to start a brand new career at an older age and not knowing if I'd be successful. But I was successful, and it was because I had good people like Harry to be a mentor to me. I think that's important. You know, look to people and please feel free. I think that's one of the most rewarding things that I've seen, and Harry is fantastic at it, is trying to, you know, bring the next generation along.
Hey, Tom, we'd like to tell them that there are, in addition to the Foreign Service exam, the Fulbrighters, which we know a lot of Holy Cross students are, we have Wrangell and Pickering Fellowships for Holy Cross students. We have Payne Fellowships for people interested in U.S. Agency for International Development, as well as Ron Brown for Foreign Commercial Service. So all of those, you know, we came in through the exam many, many years ago, which I think most people will still continue to come through. We look forward to them taking that. Lastly, as I in addition to St. Patty's Day this weekend, which is this week, which is a different kind of St. Patty's than Bob and I celebrated on campus with beer at 8:30 in the morning in the cafeteria.
Yes.
Don't be a bad example now.
Green beer and corned beef and cabbage and boxing matches in the afternoon in what is now the destroyed former field house. My last words are, when I got to Bangladesh, U.S. Navy band was playing, we were up country, and they were playing a song, and all the Bangladeshi stood up singing Amar Cowboy Joy. It was amazing. I didn't know what the heck they were talking about. Amar Cowboy Joy was We Shall Overcome. And they brought that song to Bangladesh, not knowing, Bangladeshi don't know We Shall Overcome in American terms, but that is the extent of our cultural influence, especially when we do things right.
So Harry, I like that you have hope behind you, and I think you've answered my question in one way. Maybe a quick question for each, since Bob didn't get a State Department question there at the end, but obviously you've all been through some really tough assignments, some really difficult situations, intractable sorts of things. You still seem to believe in progress. You're a hopeful people, Harry with the hope, the Obama hope behind him, but the others, how do you find hope and purpose in that? How would you tell our students that?
Well, first of all, let me tell all my fellow Holy Cross folks out there that you start from a great institution, and it really is. And for Harry and I know, because we went there together, it's a great starting point. And the Jesuit tradition of education is also there's some hope in there too. It's about the wonder of the world. And as we travel along and we see the good and the bad, I think you see more good. I've been all over the world and served in some pretty gnarly places and also some great places. But I think there's a fundamental goodness in this country and its people. And even in the darkest days, this is what motivates me today. And I'm always reminded of the oath of office that the four of us took, defend the Constitution of the United States against all enemies. And this document, the Constitution, is a brilliant document that is also hopeful. And as Dave said in the preamble, towards a more perfect union. And I love that.
Thank you.
Maybe I'll just say very shortly, very briefly, I guess I was always hopeful because things don't get better in my experience. People make things better, right? That things don't get better by themselves, that it requires people to get involved and do things. And that being involved doesn't guarantee that they will get better, but that's the best hope we have. And you know, and in fact, if you look at the history, the arc of history, it's long, but it's bent towards justice. So, you know, you got to keep working. You got to keep hoping.
Thank you. Susan?
Yeah, I mean, I would just agree with what, you know, Dave said, is that, you know, we aren't going to solve all the world's problems, but we do have, I think, a good foundation, you know, to start on. I'll just tell you, you know, you've been talking about hope. And, you know, I think Carrie mentioned that, you know, how many other countries in the world could Barack Obama have been elected president? I was in Belfast, Northern Ireland, and we had a breakfast the morning that he was elected in 2008. And I would have sworn that, you know, I had very few Americans there, but the Irish were just, they kept saying that, you know, Barack Obama was Irish and they put the O and then the little, you know, exclamation point. But it was really, it just shows you what, you know, again, that there are a lot of good things and good things don't come easily. We have to work hard at that. And I would encourage all the students, you know, to work hard and don't be afraid don't let anybody tell you you can't accomplish what you want to accomplish. You just need to work hard and, you know, ask for help when you need help and you'll find your way.
Thanks. So many great takeaways. I'm really grateful to all of you. I'm grateful you let me keep you on a little bit longer than we intended, but it was worth staying on. So thanks very much. And everyone have a good evening.
Thank you. Thanks, Tom.
Good night.